Praise God. Hallelujah. All right. Continue our study in the book of Psalms. We're going to look at Psalms 101. Continue our topic of guarding the gate. And our key verse is Psalms 101, verse number 3. I will set no wicked thing before mine eyes. I hate the work of them that turn aside. It shall not cleave to me. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, speak to our hearts today. Help us, Lord, to guard the gates. Help us, Lord, to be strong, committed, faithful to you, Lord. We lift you up, Jesus. We thank you for your word, Lord. Purify our hearts. Cleanse our hands. Help us to draw near to you today, Jesus. We lift you up. We thank you, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. You can be seated. All right, so we have been talking out of John Bunyan's book, talking about his book as our basic theme, Holy War. And we are looking at the enemy's attempts to capture man's soul. And so as you look at that, think about your soul, and the enemy is following you. So you've got to keep running, and you've got to keep moving because he's hounding you. He's like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. And so you think about prayer. We started talking about prayer last week as one of the things you can do to strengthen your city. Man's soul is a city that the enemy is coming against in his book. And basically, the enemy was able to penetrate through one of the gates, the eye gate, because he couldn't get over the wall. And so we're talking about ways that you can strengthen. Our scripture that we read is, I will set no wicked thing before mine eyes. And so we're going to talk about prayer. We talked about the first lesson that we talked about was Bible study, you know, hiding the word of God in our heart that we might not sin against God. And the second area that we're focusing on to strengthen our city's defenses is prayer. Prayer is a place of surrender. And basically what we're saying is we need God's help. You know, the enemy wants to scale the gates and cause you to give up your prayer life. That's how he's going to be able to penetrate into your walls and gates and get into the city. If he can trick you into thinking, oh, if you can just talk about prayer, think about prayer, but not really actually pray. And that's what a lot of people do. They look back, and I'm going to tell you, it's not the time that you spend in prayer. It's the quality of the prayer that matters. There's a lot of people who think that it's the amount of words that you say. Even Jesus said it's not the vain repetitions that matter. You can just say words over and over again. You're going to say 52 of these prayers in a row and move little beads. It's not the number of prayers that's important. God is looking at the prayer that comes from your heart and the quality of the prayer. And so we have a prayer closet. That is your post, is your prayer closet. And everyone has their own private place of prayer. And you have to find a place where you're comfortable to pray. I like to get up early when it's nice and quiet before all of the hustle and bustle of the day starts to kick in. My mind is clear and I can focus on the Lord. Get my Bible out and begin reading his word, meditating. You know, a prayer clock is good. Y'all have all seen the prayer clock where you spend a few minutes praying, a few minutes meditating, a few minutes reading your Bible, a few minutes listening, right? You have to put listening in there too. You have to let God talk a little bit to you too. Listen for the small, still voice. But it's basically you have to have time for God in your prayer closet. And it's a place of surrender of your time, your heart, your will. You saying to God, yes, I need you. I can't do this myself, God. I acknowledge I need a higher power. I'm not ashamed to say that I need God. I can't figure it all out. So what the devil wants us to do is get impatient with our prayer life and get distracted with our prayer life. And there's some people, they can pray for about 2 minutes and then they're bored and they get distracted and now they're off. Have you ever noticed when you're sitting in church, all of a sudden your mind will start thinking about all kinds of stuff? I say the word stuff. Start thinking about things. You know, when you come into God's house, it's best to just leave things at the door and say, God, for the next little while, I'm yours. I'm coming into your house and I'm just going to leave all of my worries and anxieties, fears, cares. I'm leaving it out there and I'm going to focus on your word. I want to come into your house and I want to listen to see what the Spirit wants to say to me. And so that's what we do when we come to God's house. We should come into God's house hungry. Right? We should be hungry for a move of God, ready to hear from God's word. Let the word speak to us. Let his Spirit speak to us. But you know, it starts with prayer. And I believe that it's, like it says here on the, it says on that slide, weeding, watering, and waiting. The word of God is going to get on the ground of your heart, but you have to break up the ground of your heart to get it ready. And I believe a lot of that happens in our prayer life. In our prayer life, we're saying, Lord, help me pull some of the weeds. Help me get some of the rocks. Help me pull out some of the things that are in the way. Speak to my heart and show me some of the things that are coming in between you and me. It's kind of like if a stream was flowing and then the stream began to be bottled up. You need to pull the things out of the stream and get it flowing again. That's what the prayer life does. The prayer life just opens up that stream and allows God to begin to speak to us once again. And so that's what we need to do with our prayer life. Because where's the battlefield happening? Right here. The enemy is going to come against your mind. Mark it down. Discouragement, depression, doubt. He wants to come into your mind and he wants to convince you that God doesn't care. God doesn't know what's going on. But you know, God is a very detailed God. If you don't think God is a detailed God, I challenge you just to go to the zoo and look at the birds. All of the different colored, beautiful birds. And you go, wow, he put a lot of thought into that one. Or how about tropical fish? All the different colors of the tropical fish. And you stand there and you go, God is amazing. All of the detail and the intricate design. Jesus said, if you look at the lilies of the field, how God took care of them, they're so beautiful. They're here today, they're gone tomorrow. You're much more important to him than flowers. So don't listen to the lies of the devil when he tries to tell you that God is not concerned about what's going on in your life. Just trust the Lord, turn it over to him, and begin to pray and believe. So what we do is we take the helmet of salvation. Now the helmet of salvation, what does the helmet do? The helmet protects you from being buffeted, bounced. Things are going to happen to you if you're not wearing that helmet. You're going to get hit in the head and you're going to get stunned. You're going to get a concussion. You're going to be stumbling around. But the helmet protects you from the blows of the enemy. And that's what he wants to do. He wants to come against your mind. But notice he says, take the helmet of salvation the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. And what's the next thing he says? Praying always. So even though you have your helmet on and you have the sword of the Spirit, you have to do your part. And your part is you're praying. You're watching. You're watching because the enemy is trying to get into man's soul. That's what it says in Holy War in John Bunyan's book. He's trying to get through the eye gate. He's trying to get into your mind. He's trying to come against you, to discourage you, to defeat you, to beat you down. But you're going to say, no, devil, you can't have my mind. You can't have my mind. I'm going to strap my helmet up tight, and I am going to be ready when the enemy comes against me for whatever he throws against me. The enemy loves it when the Christians fall into the temptation of substitutes for prayer. I love to hear sermons on prayer, read books on prayer, attend prayer conferences, go to men's conferences. All of those things are awesome. However, they can never actually take the place of prayer. They're not a substitute for prayer. I'll take it a step further. The enemy will get you so busy with things that all of a sudden you realize, I don't have time to pray. And you're so busy running and running and running, and you look around and you realize, it's noon and I haven't even said one word to God yet. I'm so busy trying to do this myself. However, let's look at our example. For even hereunto were ye called, because Christ also suffered for us, leaving us an example. So Jesus was God manifest in the flesh. He robed himself in the flesh, and he walked among us for many reasons. One of them was to be our perfect example. He showed us how to live, that you should follow his steps. What would Jesus do? Right? WWJD. What would Jesus do? What would Jesus do? And when he had sent the multitudes away, he went up into a high mountain apart to pray. That's what Jesus would do. Whenever he was going to face a challenge or any kind of a situation or anything at all that came, he prayed. He prepared himself. Then cometh Jesus with them unto a place called Gethsemane, and saith unto the disciples, sit ye here while I go and pray yonder. They have a thing now, they say, bucket list. You have your bucket list, right? These are all the things I want to do with the time that I have left. You think Jesus knew his time was short? Jesus knew his time was short. Let's go to Gethsemane. Sit here while I go and pray. This is how I'm going to spend my last few hours of freedom. I'm going to be in prayer. And in the morning, rising up a great while before day, he went out and departed into a solitary place and there prayed. Can you see a pattern in his life? Everything he faced came to pass. About 8 days after these things, he took Peter and John and James and went up to a high mountain to pray. And I noticed this for the first time. You know, I usually read this transfiguration. It's also in Matthew 17 is where I usually read it at. But this is Luke's, where he's talking about it. And it's saying he went up into a high mountain to pray. And as he prayed, he was transfigured. That's pretty awesome. Luke gives you a little more insight into it. He was actually praying as he was transfigured. So that's pretty awesome. That reveals a little more of the countenance was altered. His raiment became white. And they saw Moses and Elijah. So it was while he was praying that he was transfigured. And he said unto them, when ye pray. He didn't say unto them, if ye pray. Right? What'd he say? When. The way that I read that is, he wants us to pray. When you pray, this is what I want you to say. When thou prayest, enter into thy closet. And when thou hast shut thy door, pray to thy Father which is in secret. And thy Father which seeth in secret shall reward thee openly. But when ye pray, use not vain repetitions as the heathen do, for they think they shall be heard for their much speaking. It's not the number of words that matters. It's the quality of the prayer that matters. That's what God cares about. Is the prayer coming from your heart? You can stand there and pray for hours. But is your prayer getting through to God? I have to share this story with you from the men's conference. It was just so powerful. The preacher, he was up there talking about he had a heart attack. And he was gone. I mean, he was in a coma. He was in the hospital. People were coming. This is Brother LaCombs. He was giving his personal testimony. And he said, he was in the bed in a coma. People were coming from everywhere to pray for him. And this is just a testimony on the power of prayer. And they all were praying for him, and the doctor was in there in the room with him. And so all day long, people were in the room praying with him, in and out of the room. So finally the doctor said, came and told his wife, this is it. Say your final goodbyes. I'm going to shut the machines off, and there'll be about 20 minutes, and he'll be gone. I'm not seeing any signs of recovery. This is it. And so he ushers out all of the people, and they're all out down in the waiting room. And so he's standing there. It's just the doctor, and he's laying there in the bed, and there's a knock on the door. And he looks at the door, and there's this old man standing there at the door, and the old man says, I would like to have my chance to pray for him. And the doctor's like, everybody has been here all day praying for him, and I've already given everybody a chance. He said, but you know what? If you made it past security and you're here, what's 5 minutes going to hurt? I'll give you 5 minutes to pray with you. So he steps back. The doctor steps back and lets the old man go and pray for him. And he said the old man prayed the simplest prayer. He said it was a very simple prayer. God, I know you're hearing my prayer. I know you sent me here to pray for him, and I know you can heal him. I'm giving you the glory for it right now, God, in Jesus' name. Looked at the doctor and thanked him. Thank you for letting me pray for him, sir. He followed the man to the door, locks the door. Looks back over at Brother LaCombs, and he's fixing to reach up to shut off the machine, and he notices the gauge going. He starts looking at all of his other instruments, and they're all moving up. He stops, unlocks the door real quick, steps out, and there's the nurse's station right there, and he looks at the nurse. He looks down this way. He looks down that way. He said, nurse, where's that old man that was just right here? The nurse looks at him and says, doctor, you've been here all day and you're tired. There was nobody here. Prayer. The power of prayer. We all know who that old man was. God is powerful, folks. God can do anything. I never want to limit God. I do not want to limit the Holy One of Israel. You have not because you ask not. Sometimes we just don't ask. We have a God who can do anything. And he's saying to us, pray. Daniel knew that the writing was signed. He went to his house. The writing said, if you pray to anyone else besides the king, you are going to be thrown into a den of lions. And they told Daniel. They were all spying on him. And they said, Daniel, he signed it. So Daniel knew. He knew what it meant. But guess what? He went to his house. His windows were open. He wasn't trying to hide it. He kneeled upon his knees 3 times a day and prayed and gave thanks before his God as he did aforetime. I'm not changing my pattern. I don't care what the devil says. I don't care what the devil says. You know, I was reading a story. I had a book that I was reading a while back, and it was talking about some of the oppression of godly people in America. You may think, oh, it can't happen in America, folks. Yes, it can. You know, I was listening to a talk show host the other day, and he was talking about it. UCLA, they're so worried about these Jewish students, how they're being assaulted, literally physically assaulted, just trying to go to class in the building. They're surrounding the buildings. They're writing all over the walls with spray paint, Intifada, which to a Jew, he knows exactly what that means. We will kill you. That means terrorism. We will kill the Jews. That's what Intifada means to the Hamas. And so you're trying to walk to class and you can see spray painted on the wall, Intifada. Please don't turn your back. We'll kill you. Okay, so tell me that's not a hostile learning environment. How can you sit in class and learn and they're allowing it to go on? Okay, so they're telling the Jews. And I listened to this and I was like, what? If you're a Jewish student, come around and use this door. And I was thinking, ooh, well, why don't we just put a yellow star on them? And we'll just have a little special class for them and separate them over here. We'll separate them out. Or I got a better deal. Why don't we make all the terrorists leave? How about that? Yeah. Hey, that was free. That wasn't part of my lesson. I just put that in there for free. In fact, this really did my heart some good. One of the lessons they were teaching, Brother Lacombs was teaching, and he was talking about the generations. And this, I got to say, this men's conference was a little different than most, the way that the Spirit led. The first night was powerful. It was repentance. Every man prayed. The message was powerful. Get in the altar and pray. The other messages to me, I felt in my spirit, were more uplifting, building, almost like teaching. That's how I felt it. The other guys may feel a little bit differently, but that's how I felt in my spirit. It was more of a teaching and uplifting kind of a men's conference, which to me is a little different than the way it usually flows. Usually it's like this the whole time. Like I said, it was like that the first night. After that, it was just kind of like build. But he was talking about, one of the men was up there talking about, in the morning, he was preaching about generations. And he was talking about David when he didn't want the light to go out in Israel. And David went to fight the giant. He had already fought a giant before and defeated the giant. But now David was old and he was trying to fight the giant. And the giant was about to defeat him. And so the younger generation stepped in front of him and defeated the giant for David. And so they were talking about how the generation, it was like bridging the generation gap. There comes a point where the younger generations need to step up and take the torch and start to fight. And I thought, that is so good. That is so true. There comes a point where you can teach them, you can show them, you can reach out to them, but there comes a point where they have to actually do. You know, and that's what that lesson was about. It was basically the younger generation has to step up. And I saw something the other day that just did my heart so much good. Yes, ma'am. There was other giants after Goliath. They had to fight giants. It was his nephew. I'll have to go back and look at the exact scripture, but it was in 2 Samuel was the one he was preaching from. But it was on the Sunday morning messages. And he told you the guy's name that stepped in and took the giant, had a new sword, and But it's a powerful message. But that's basically the theme of his message, was the younger generation has to step up and fight. And so when they were, these protesters were at the University of North Carolina. I don't know if y'all saw that or not, but they were basically Hamas, waving the Hamas and the Hezbollah flags and hollering about how evil America is, and they pulled down the American flag, and they were raising up the Hamas flag in the center of the campus. And so the president of the college, instead of making them leave, came out there and raised the American flag back up. And so they went to pull it back down and put the Hamas flag back up. And a group of students on their own surrounded the flagpole and raised the American flag up and held it and surrounded it. And they were holding on to the American flag and would not let these terrorist kids pull that American flag down. And they were throwing water bottles at them and rocks and everything. And they were holding on to the American flag, and they started singing, United States of America, God bless the USA, America the beautiful. And the other people were over there chanting Hamas, 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 and they were singing USA, USA, and then more and more kids started coming and getting around the flag singing USA, 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 shouting down the Hamas kids. And it just did my heart so much good to see that. Nobody told those kids to do that, but just something rose up inside of them. And just, it did me good to see that. The house of God is a house of prayer. This must be the house of prayer. Folks, we have got to pray. And I feel very strongly about this. When we come in the mornings, it gets to be 15, 10 minutes before church, and they're done playing their songs. Let's turn our thoughts and our minds, our hearts towards God, and let's start ushering in His presence. That's what we need to do. We need to get His presence in here, because without His Spirit, it's just words. Right? The letter kills, the Spirit gives life. You've got to have God's Spirit. And that's so vitally important, to have the Spirit of God leading our services. They that worship Him must worship in spirit and in truth. I don't want to just have truth. We have truth. I believe that. I believe God has revealed the truth to us, and we have truth, but I never want to forget the Spirit. Even them will I bring to my holy mountain and make them joyful in my house of prayer. Their burnt offerings, their sacrifices shall be accepted upon mine altar, for mine house shall be called an house of prayer for all people. Amen. That's the scripture Jesus was quoting as He flipped over their tables. It's written, my house is called the house of prayer for all people. And we must never forget that. This is the house of prayer. So when we come to God's house, prayer should be on our minds. But I will take it a step further. This should not be the only prayer that you're getting. You can't just say, I'm going to come to God's house and pray for a few minutes and I feel like I prayed all I need to pray for the week. I encourage you to have a time that you set aside for God, and you will not let any distractions. This is God's time. Now, things pop up. I understand it from time to time. But you pull aside. As soon as it slows down a little bit, and you say, God, now you have my attention. I want to get your attention. I want to reach out and talk to you right now. I found this little poem right here, and it's so true. I read the words of this poem, and it's so true. It's entitled simply, Too Busy to Pray. I got up early one morning and rushed right into the day. I had so much to accomplish that I didn't take time to pray. Problems just tumbled about me, and heavier came each task. Why doesn't God help me? I wondered. He answered, you didn't ask. I tried to come into God's presence. I used all my My slide didn't fit. Oh well, I ran out of room. I wanted to see joy and beauty, but the day toiled on gray and bleak. I wondered why God didn't show me. He answered, but you didn't seek. I woke up early this morning and paused before entering the day. I had so much to accomplish that I had to take time to pray. And that's so true. You will get so much more done if you pray. It's like cutting your grass. You can go real slow with a dull blade on your mower, or you can take a few minutes up front and sharpen that blade and go a lot quicker. Which would you rather do? You can just keep beating on a tree with a dull axe, or you can take time and sharpen your axe. We can't do it without God. Sometimes we're swinging an empty axe handle, wondering why the tree won't come down. And God is saying, let me help you. But we have to ask. Prayer allows spiritual authority that comes to life. Prayer allows it to come into our lives. You know, when we pray, that's when God is able to move. When we turn it over to God and we say, Lord, I want to give this to you right now. I want to turn it over to you. We bring God. It's like when Jesus was asleep in the boat and they were doing everything they could, trying to get the water out, trying to fight the storm. And finally somebody says, why don't we wake up Jesus? And that's what we do so many times. We're fighting and struggling and pushing and running and jumping and stuff. We just want to scream. And God is sitting there going, I'm right here. All you got to do is ask. There are things that will help you to put your mind into an attitude of prayer. Now, like I said, books are not a substitute for prayer. But that doesn't mean that books aren't good. Books can, and I'm a big advocate of books, and I tell you what, they have not had a Pentecostal publishing house at the men's conference the past three times. And they were there this time. Oh my goodness. Yeah, I'm a victim. I can quit anytime I want. I was back at those tables in between every preacher. You can ask Brother Jimmy. I was like, I want that book. By the time I left, I had a stack of books like that. Yeah, there were so many good books. I was like trying to decide which book I wanted. But books on prayer are helpful and to get you into a mindset. You know, reading some other people's thoughts throughout the years on prayer can just kind of help to get you into the mind of prayer. It doesn't take the place of prayer. It's not a substitute for prayer, but it kind of can help you to get your mind to there. And I'm going to show you a couple of good books. This is my new book I just got by Ken Gurley. And it's the book on prayer. And I've just started reading it. And I'm like in the third chapter, and I like it. I really like it. And he says, the same kind of prayer that brought nations... He's talking about the same kind of prayer. We need the same kind of prayer that they had that made our nation great, is what he's talking about. We need to get back to prayer. The same kind of prayer that brought nations back to God and to health, turned the hearts of sinners to the ark of safety, wrecked selfishness and wrought selflessness. The same kind of prayer that turns the world upside down, births ministry and evangelism, forges growth and discipleship. These things were brought about by prayer. And so he basically then goes through and he's going to quote some of the great people, historical people throughout time who have spoken on the topic of prayer. This is what John Wesley wrote on prayer. He said, for if all your arguments and persuasiveness fail, there is yet another remedy left, and one that is frequently found effectual when no other method avails. This is prayer. So you've tried all these other things. Pray. That's what John Wesley said. Therefore, whatsoever you desire or want, either for others or for your own soul, ask, and it shall be given you. This is Charles Haddon Spurgeon. Every promise of the Scripture is a writing of God, which may be pleaded before Him with this reasonable request. Do as thou hast said. This is what you can tell God if there's a promise in His Word. Do as thou hast said. The Creator will not cheat His creature who depends upon His truth. And far more, the Heavenly Father will not break His Word to His own child. Remember the word unto thy servant on which thou hast caused me to hope is the most prevalent pleading. Remember your word, Lord. I'm hoping on your word. This is your promise. I'm resting on your promise. You said, Lord, in your word. You said, God, that if I raised up a child in the way in which he should go, when he's old, he will not depart from it. I'm holding you to that promise, Lord. I'm not seeing it right now, but I'm believing you, God. I'm believing you. Their heart is coming home. Anybody praying for your kids? You can hold him to his word. It says it right there in the Scripture. Raise them up in the way they should go. My own soul, this is also from Spurgeon, my own soul's conviction is that prayer is the grandest power in the entire universe. That it is more, that it has more omnipotent force than electricity, attraction, gravitation, or any of those other secret forces which men have called by name, but which they do not understand. And of course, he lived in the 1800s. There's a lot he did not know about electricity or magnetism or any of that. He just knew it was there. But he knew that prayer is powerful. I like this one. This is also from Spurgeon. Until the gate of hell is shut upon a man, we must not cease to pray for him. And if we see him hugging the very doorposts of damnation, we must go to the mercy seat and beseech the arm of grace to pluck him from his dangerous position. While there is life, there is hope. And although the soul is almost smothered with despair, we must not despair for it, but rather arouse ourselves to awaken the Almighty arm. Woo! They called him the Prince of Preachers. He was a little bit eloquent. Delayed answers are not only trials of faith, but they give us an opportunity of honoring God by our steadfast confidence in Him under apparent repulses. In other words, we don't give up. Even though we don't get our answer today or tomorrow, we continue to believe God that He is going to answer us. I'm going to talk about another man. We're going to look at some of his books. And this is E.M. Bounds. All true revivals have been born in prayer. I believe when they were all in one mind and one accord on the day of Pentecost, what do you think that one mind and one accord was? I believe they were praying. They were waiting for the promise of the Father. They had one mind, one accord, and they were praying, believing God that He was going to pour out His Spirit, just like He promised that He would. Jesus told them, John baptized with water, but you shall be baptized with the Holy Ghost not many days hence. And they were there waiting for the promise, praying, believing, hoping. And we saw, you talk about a revival, thousands of souls that first day. Wouldn't it be awesome if thousands of souls poured in here? Amen. And they were all the way out the door. And we had to say, we'll get to you as fast as we can. That would make me very happy. Amen. But I know that God can speak to hearts, but he wants us to do our part, and that is to pray. This is the house of prayer. All true revivals have been born in prayer. When you read about Azusa Street and that mighty outpouring, the people would get over there and they would just gather around in that old, it was like a stable, an old stable. And the people would get in there, probably smelled like horses. People got in there anyway, and guess what they did? They prayed and believed that God was going to pour out his Spirit. And guess what? There was many mighty miracles. In fact, they were praying in one house on the front porch, and there were so many people on that porch, the porch collapsed. So many people. I would like to see that. So many people crowded in there. They said, we're going to have to find a new place because there's too many people to fit on this front porch. But it all starts with prayer. What the church needs today, this is Edward McKendry Bounds. What the church needs today is not more machinery or better or new organizations or more or novel methods, but men whom the Holy Ghost can use, men of prayer, men mighty in prayer. The Holy Ghost does not flow through methods, but through men. He does not come on machinery, but on men. He does not anoint plans, but men, men of prayer. That's what we need, is prayer warriors. And of course, when he says men, he's speaking of people, all people. You understand that, and it's just how they talked back then. When they say men, mankind. But God wants to use all of us in prayer, to have an attitude of prayer and worship and say like this, Jesus, you can use anything. You can use me. I may not be able to speak that well or teach a great Bible study or do any of that, but I can pray. All of us can pray. And we can all bind together in unity as one and lift our voices and ask God to move in a mighty way and believe God for revival. That's what God wants us to do. Now, I'm just about out of time this morning. We'll get into it next week. But he has a series of 8 books, and you can get it for very reasonable on like Amazon. They put them into one volume, but the complete works on prayer. He wrote 8 books about prayer, necessity of prayer, essentials of prayer. My favorite is possibilities of prayer, a reality of prayer, purpose in prayer, weapon of prayer, power through prayer, praying men. But like I said, you can get it all in one hardcover volume where they put all the books into one volume for you. But you go through and you read these books, and that's all he talks about is prayer. And when you read it, it will inspire you as you're praying. And it's not a substitute for prayer. You can't read it and go, well, I did my prayer for today. I read this book or read a chapter on prayer in Ian Bounds. No, it should encourage you to want to pray. It turns your mind. It helps you to get your mind focused on prayer and to believe in the power of prayer, the possibility of prayer. So it's to help you pray. And so next week we will focus on that. Let's stand. I want to get to my song here. Take a moment. Talk to the Lord. It's all about your prayer life. That's what I want to see. I want to see you and strengthen your talk, your walk with God.